Hey, story fans, I'm the writing ref, where I don't hate, I just officiate your favorite, holy cow, best Star Wars we've had in a long time.
In a long time. A long time.
There was a lot to unpack this episode, so we're going to get started doing that right now.
Somehow Palpatine returned.
Rebellion Palmy to protect them. What if they get sick?
I titled this video about how Force Ghosts are explained for a reason. But really, that's at the core of this episode, and at the core of everything Star Wars. But to really explain what I mean by all this, we need to recap the entire episode. So, I can go through the plot of The Shadow Warrior in one breath. So if you don't want to be spoiled, you should probably cut the floor out from under you and drop on out of here. But do come back once you've watched the episode. So Hera and Jason land to see if they can figure out what happened to Ahsoka and Sabine. Hera and the X-Wing pilots have nothing on sensors, but Huyang is there to be all sad that Jedi's never be following his advice. Meanwhile, on the spiritual plane of existence, Anakin and Ahsoka banter about age, losing fights, and how he's there to complete her training. The final lesson is to live or die, which naturally means a lightsaber fight must ensue because Star Wars, and it is rad. Meanwhile, Jason is all, Mom, Mummy, Mom, Mum, Mummy, and she's like, what? And Jason's like, don't you hear the lightsabers? And then the Force theme, and then Hera, and it's kind of like, yeah, kind of. Okay, so let's go searching the ocean.
Okay.
And back in Jedi Purgatory, Ahsoka gets cocky with Anakin, but he's like, lols, and cuts the floor from under her, and she falls like Gandalf, again, into her past self. Ahsoka is a full-grown woman and a teenage body, and somehow Anakin is not upset about all the sand blowing around, and instead tries to teach Ahsoka as she relives her past. Anakin imparts good wisdom until he gets fed up with her bad attitude and decides to go all dark side on her orange buttocks. And it is brutal and awesome. And probably this was happening for people lucky enough to see it in theaters. Eventually, Ahsoka, quote-unquote, wins, but it's the final test and she throws the saber down and Anakin is all beaming with pride, but pieces out so Ahsoka can go through a baptism ritual. While all this is happening, somewhere in between the live-action Clone Wars, Hera is told to fly as low as possible by Chopper, and eventually, Ahsoka is found. Okay, so maybe more than one breath, but Ahsoka dons some white clothes, figures out that the big space whales might take them to follow the bad guys, and basically the Purrgil agree. So the New Republic fleet, coming to punish Hera for her disobedience, has to get the F out of the way of the whales, and they hyperspace jump into storylines unknown. Okay, so, any questions?
Oh, hey, Navi.
Hello.
Hey, look, story fans, it's Navi. She has a home right behind this shield. She, has kind of a cheap animation budget right now, because I only have 50 subscribers, so maybe if you subscribed and helped me get to 100 subscribers, I could afford to hire an animation team.
Hey!
And make Navi look even better. Anyway, Navi brings news to me from the internet, since I don't have all day to just browse internet rumors. What have you got for me, Navi?
Hey! Listen!
I feel like we've been here before. Have we been here before?
You're kidding me.
This is happening again!
This article says that if Anakin were a Force ghost, his Vader side would arguably be purged, and only the good side of him would remain.
Incorrect.
There's still people asking if that Anakin is the real Anakin or just some kind of fever dream.
Okay, seriously, first off,
Force ghost.
What is that? What even is that?
Look, I am not sure if this is actually Anakin's Force ghost or not.
Oh my god!
And really, it doesn't matter because this is like a journey for Ahsoka.
Incorrect.
I'm kidding, of course. I love Ryan Airy and his silly little dog. I mean, boss. You should go check out his channel if you haven't. I'll put a link in the description. People thinking Anakin is just a fever dream or Force vision doesn't bother me. much.
How can you joke at a time like this?
Because otherwise my YouTube videos would be boring. Plus, Dave Filoni said he wants the main plot device of this episode, The World Between Worlds, to remain ambiguous.
I don't know how real it actually is. I don't want to define that for people anyway. But it's not this place of gateways and doorways that you just go in and out of.
Which naturally means us Star Wars fans are going to be arguing about it till the end of time, so I might as well start now.
Hey, listen!
Yeah, Navi? Well, I really haven't finished answering the first...
Hey, listen!
Well, you see...
Hey, listen!
Sometimes Navi can get a little annoying. Seriously, Navi, stop! I think I can answer all these questions at once. Do I need to use this? Alright, where were we? I was saying, Internet, I believe I have the answer to all your questions with one major revelation. And you don't even have to have seen Rebels or Clone Wars.
What?
That's right. You can understand everything in Episode 5 of Ahsoka with a little movie that came out in 1977 called Star Wars.
Okay.
What I'm about to tell you, story fans, I have not seen anywhere on the internet. And I do look at a lot of YouTube channels and articles. I've seen some people get close. But if what I'm about to say blows your mind, please share it. And don't just share it with one friend, but all the friends, because they all need to know. You ready? This place, where Anakin and Ahsoka are interacting, is the method and the means by which some Jedi disappear when they die.
You can't win, Darth. Strike me down, I shall become more powerful than you can possibly imagine.
So that's right. The more powerful than you can possibly imagine is because of this place. How do I know this? Well, there's a conversation that almost everyone missed. Because you'll be surprised to know, it's not between Anakin and Ahsoka.
Maybe those senators were right. They got us out here chasing ghosts. Yu Yang, where are they? People don't just vanish into thin air.
Well, no. Normally, no.
In this seemingly innocent conversation, Huyang is referring to this. And this. And eventually, even this. Now, since Ahsoka is on the verge of death, as far as anyone knows, for the first time, even though it's kind of the third time, she is able to access this place. And, had she failed her lesson with Anakin, or succumbed to the duel, she would have left some very wet clothes in the ocean, but probably disappeared to end up here and transition the rest of the way into the Force. Now, there's a canon book called Return of the Jedi from a certain point of view. A short story by Mike Chinn details Anakin's point of view as he transitions into the Force, and who else helps him with that transition other than Obi-Wan? Obi-Wan was waiting to help Anakin return to his conscious form. And I believe that Anakin is now awaiting for Ahsoka. That's why he tells her this at the end of Episode 4.
I didn't expect to see you so soon.
Now, from what the episode tells us, this place is a bridgeway from the living world to the spirit world. If we cheat and look at Rebels a little bit, we also know that it's outside time and space, and provides ultimate knowledge. And it's this ultimate knowledge that Baylan Skoll wants.
Power. Such as you've never dreamed.
More powerful than you can possibly imagine.
But this episode, in the end, is not really about the power of this place. Not yet. It's about the struggle between life and death. In fact, this seemingly innocent conversation...
You look the same.
You look old.
Well, that happens.
Is really about the inevitability of death. When Ahsoka says, yeah, that happens, I get old. Well, what happens after you get old? Well, Anakin here can be compared to all those folks that you meet on the other side when you're about to die, and they say, it's not your time yet. Kind of like Rocket Raccoon's friends in the latest Guardians movie, or the Deadpool's wife in Deadpool 2. But Anakin's a little bit more than even that. He's not just a greeter saying it's not your time yet. He is Ahsoka's, and maybe the Force's, literal god of death. Especially considering how important Anakin is to the saga. This is our chance, as fans, to see him as he was always destined to be, in control of both light and dark. Now, many of my favorite YouTubers have pointed out that Shadow Warrior, the title of this episode, probably is in reference to a movie that George Lucas worked on with Akira Kurosawa, one of his mentors. It was called Kage Musha, or Shadow Warrior. But what everyone doesn't know that I have some experience with is Samurai Code. And one of the most important proverbs in samurai culture is a little phrase called Ichigo Ichie. I think everyone pretty much knows, because of high school English, about the philosophy of Carpe Diem, seize the day. Ichigo Ichie has no literal English translation, but to the samurai it meant something much deeper than seize the day. It's when your life hangs in the balance of the knife edge of a very sharp sword. Every moment of every part of our existence, you can only have once, and then it's gone. So the samurai's choice is to reject the fear of death, or fight and conquer the fear of death, and choose life in every moment.
I gave you a choice. Live. Or die.
Thus, Ichigo Ichie means, in every moment, choose life.
I choose to live.
And that's exactly what Ahsoka does. And it's at the heart, the real lesson Anakin has to impart to his student. In the end, we all are students, and we all eventually become teachers. But hey, that's just my take on the episode. What's yours? Did you disagree with anything? Throw the red flag, challenge flag, and leave a comment, and I'll engage you there. I love to have a discussion, especially about Star Wars at this level. And we'll see you next time. Riding Ref out.